I've got a good Ranger buddy that was in the military with me, but he's phenomenal at marketing and social media and getting his story out. I mean, he's just good at that. I tell you, he has been able to get so much going with other local producers, you know, combining chefs and butchers with producers. And so, you know, you just talk about, you know, different opportunities, not being so, oh, well, I don't own a farm, or, you know, I don't produce anything. Well, you can still heavily be involved in agriculture. You know, I grew up a city kid in Little Rock. I mean, my extent of knowing anything about agriculture was shelling purple hull peas from my grandparents' small garden, and you know, my grandpa carrying a salt shaker in his back pocket when we went to pick tomatoes. You know, that was about all I knew about you know, being a farmer. So when I got out of the military, I, you know, obviously had to do a lot of soul searching. You know, 5 deployments between Iraq and Afghanistan, and you know, that takes a toll on you, emotionally, physically, mentally. And so I took a high-powered, great-paying sales job, but my quality of life was awful. I was searching for something. I was searching for a way to serve, and agriculture gave me that. My military background, you know, I was in the 2nd Ranger Battalion, and which was a, you know, all 8 cylinders, op tempo. I enlisted in the military pre-9/11. The first week I was at my permanent duty station, which was Fort Lewis, Washington, 9/11 happened. You know, we were watching planes at the tower, and at that moment, you know, I had been pretty well trained up, but I had no idea what was, you know, how my life had just changed. And, you know, so my wife married a soldier, and she told me, she said, hey, look, I support you as a soldier if you want to re-enlist, but if you want to start a family, you got to get out, you know. And so I agreed to it, got out. I landed just an amazing job, but you know, I was traveling 75% of the time, and just something in my gut just wasn't, you know, I loved my job and I was making just great money. But like I said, something was missing. So my wife and I started praying about it, and we were, you know, we were determined we were gonna make a change. We were gonna figure something out. I was gone too much. We were trying to raise our family. We had 2 kids at the time, Luke and Olivia. And we had left church on a Sunday afternoon and just decided to take a drive. And we had been on the road for, you know, 30 minutes, and there was a sign at the end of this road. Well, before we got there, we actually saw this place for sale. The view that you guys can see right now was what we saw. And so I remember pulling up in the drive, and just you know, 20 yards over there, I remember I reached over and I grabbed my wife's hand. And I said, "You better get me out of here. We're gonna buy this place." I fell in love, and I don't know what it was, but there was just something calling me here. Man, I don't tread on that lightly. I feel like God gave me a purpose and an opportunity in agriculture. And here again, coming from a city kid that didn't know the first thing about planting or a cow or a pig or a chicken. I mean, I didn't know anything about it, but I felt a purpose and I was driven on that. So we bought this farm, right? Okay, now what? I was looking at, you know, planting tobacco, cotton, soybeans. Like, I didn't know what I was gonna do. I just knew that I had this land that I had to do something with. They were talking about sustainable agriculture, and they were talking about this kooky guy that lives over in the Shenandoah Valley named Joel Salatin. I mean, I remember thinking, this is what I wanna do. Symbiotic relationship on the farm. Your animals, you treat them like employees, and they work your farm, and you rotationally graze, and you know, your cows eat your grass, your chickens fertilize your fields, your pigs work the woods. And I was like, man, this is awesome. So that's what we did. Our first year, we did you know, we raised about 2,500 chickens. We made some good money, and we started seeing that come in. So from there, I laid that over and bought a couple of mama cows, and bought some feeder steers so I could get beef going, and you know, bought some hogs, and started turning, you know, some pork. And from there, okay, I'm officially a farmer now, and I'm selling some stuff at farmers markets and things like that, but farmers markets are seasonal. You know, so how am I gonna take what I'm producing? Where am I gonna go with it? And just down the road from the farm, there was this little old store. And so that's what this is. We ended up, you know, buying Crow Station, opened it up, and put in the old Crow General Store. And I remember when I first opened up, there wasn't anything in there but 3 freezers that I had painted black, and I put chicken, beef, and pork in each freezer. And people would come in and they're like, what are you doing? I'm like, oh, I'm a farmer down the road, and you can buy the stuff. And then very rapidly that grew to, you know, other producers that were in the state. Lady down the road that makes jams and jellies, and you know, a guy that grows awesome tomatoes, and people started just really coming out of the woodwork. And then more people stopped in and said, what do you do? And, oh, well, I sell local goods from local farmers. Oh, you're like a farmer's market. Yeah, except I don't close. I'm open year round. There was a desire from the local community that wanted to shop local. They wanted to support their local businesses. They wanted to know where their food came from. And that's a big thing, right? And that's where it started getting exciting, is that we could connect people with their food again. You know, the old homesteading type things. People want to know more about canning. And I mean, there's just so many opportunities that really come out of it.